As the warmer days of summer embraced the ecosystem pond, life developed remarkably. Things were in full effect, from the birds to the amphibians and even the fish. The eastern phoebe cared for their second brood of the season, who grew quickly and eventually left the nest. This concluded their time at the pond until next spring, which also gave the insects a break from their predation. That's when I took the time to craft a pollinator garden, complete with a mini waterfall fountain for them to drink from. These details further evolved the entire dynamic of everything from an aesthetic and functional perspective. In no time, butterflies and bees were enjoying the flowers. As breathtaking as that was, an elaborate microcosm was at play just below the surface, which could easily be overlooked. Invertebrates of all kinds inhabited nearly every square inch of space. Spiders wove webs to ensnare their victims, while millipedes marched up mountainous terrain. It was incredible, and on a fundamental level, invertebrates are the backbone and foundation of any healthy ecosystem. In fact, 97% of animal life is comprised of such beings. Without them, nothing would work as it should. The frogs wouldn't have anything to eat, the birds wouldn't be able to rear their young, and so much more. That's why I put so much thought into developing features like the pollinator garden. I love the appearance of beautiful flowers, and the bright colors help draw in the pollinating insects who meticulously search for nectar or pollen in each one. As a result, this became an extremely active area of the pond. Butterflies, moths, bees, and other creatures worked non-stop. There were even hummingbird moths, which are an oddity. They look just like hummingbirds, but are in reality moths. Incredible. The milkweed even attracted the most famous butterflies of all, monarchs, but they weren't here to breed. They were simply passing through, gaining sustenance as they migrated south to Mexico. Their offspring's offspring will return to this very plant next year to lay eggs. Another creature called this place home, milkweed aphids. Swamp milkweed like this one is one of their favorite places to congregate and feed. They're toxic to most other creatures, but one of their few predators was aware of their presence, and aphids happened to be one of their favorite foods. This ladybug was on the hunt, keen to track them down. To their dismay, it eventually found them and began feasting. Milkweed bugs also fed on the plants if they weren't busy breeding. There were even bizarre-looking creatures emerging from the waters to complete their transformation into something beautiful, damselflies and dragonflies. These gorgeous little jewels of the pond flew back and forth in search of prey, occasionally resting on marginal plants. One was even curious about the tripod. Like everything, some thrived and others did not. Luckily, the ants were ready to recycle their remains. These micro-titans of the animal world are key to the health of many ecosystems. Here, colonies are peppered throughout the landscape around the pond. Feverishly marching back and forth, they gathered food for their growing colonies in lands unseen. Their presence, however, caused an unfortunate issue: aphids on the water lilies. Ants often farm them in exchange for their excrement, a sweet nectar known as honeydew. This made the lilies appear worse for wear, which I didn't appreciate. The days were long and the sun was hot, which caused a lot of activity, but the evenings were just as eventful. Different creatures like spiders, predatory beetles, and moths emerged in the landscape. Meanwhile, the fish and tadpoles blissfully swam throughout the backlit waters, unaware of their surroundings. A few raccoons occasionally showed up, scavenging the rocks for fish food I may have dropped. In the skies above, bats quickly darted around, allowing for just a fleeting view. However, the real action was occurring in the surrounding areas. Thousands of little lights blinked on and off from the end of bioluminescent fireflies. They were in search of one another, hoping to mate. Something equally astounding began occurring at the pond, which I noticed one day while cleaning the basin.
I went and cleaned out the skimmer here just a little bit ago, and as I was walking over, I thought I saw a bunch of crickets jumping around until I realized what was actually going on.
The thousands of tadpoles that called these waters home for many weeks were completing their metamorphosis into toads. Some still had tails, while others took their first steps on solid ground. These tiny toads, which were hardly the size of a fingernail, were everywhere. They hid within moss, plants, and rocks, which is one of their preferred hunting grounds. Any micro critters like springtails were on the menu. The area near the top of the waterfalls was especially teeming with toads. Their parents were wise to produce so many eggs, which resulted in thousands of toads. The journey into toadhood wouldn't be without peril, because they too were on the menu. Being this tiny made them extremely vulnerable to any predators in the area. The grounds were full of spiders much larger than the toads. The ringneck snake from months prior also returned and likely to eat toads. A garter snake was on the prowl too. As adorable as these little toads are, there would likely be an imbalance without predation. Checks and balances naturally occur as one species takes advantage of another. While small, the toadlets would remain in close proximity to the pond. Throughout the remainder of the season, they'd grow and slowly move away from the waters and towards the woods. However, they weren't the only animals growing. That random bullfrog from the spring decided to make this pond home and was getting big. Funny enough, almost immediately after the toads left the waters of the pond, newcomers emerged. The goldfish must have been busy doing their thing in early spring because baby fish were everywhere. This was exciting to see, and surely will happen year after year. That's no problem for now, because such a pond could easily accommodate more fish. With the tadpoles gone, I could finally remove the algae too. Getting it out of the way is always so satisfying, especially in this area. Handful after handful, the wetlands were freed from its grasp. I also took this time to thin out and trim a lot of the mint. All the while, a young frog observed from a nearby rock. I also noticed the commotion at a tree I recently planted, where a little song sparrow was watching over a brood of eggs. In no time, they hatched and were completely reliant on their parents. Luckily, their parents were working non-stop to collect food as the nestlings grew. However, it happened so quickly that I completely missed their departure from the nest. This all made room for plants that I got months before. They had been sitting in this tub for so long that many were growing out of the sides of their pots. Anyway, I planted these throughout the wetlands. As they grow and develop, they'll bolster the filtration capacity of the pond by pulling excess nutrients from the water column. The added foliage would create more habitat for various animals, too. I also took this opportunity to clean the aphids off the lilies and give them a better chance. Then I netted algae out of the basin itself. All of this helped balance things out, but it would take even more time for the pond to grow and stabilize. There was still so much work to be done, life would continue to develop, and in due time, the vision truly began unfolding. All of that and more in the conclusion of this series in just a few weeks. See you next time, Serpa Squad.